Alright, in this video we want to talk about solving radical equations, but first we have to start with an observation. So consider the following two equations. Consider 2x is equal to 10 and 3x plus 2 equals 17. So I see that the number that makes this first equation true is 5. Let me put that number in what we call braces. So 5 makes this equation true. Now you may notice that 5 also makes this equation true. So let me put that in braces. So 5 is the only number that makes both equations true, right? For that reason, we call these equations equivalent. So when somebody says two equations are equivalent, what that means is that they have the same solution set. And that means that the same set of numbers make the equations true. Both of these equations are true only when x is 5, and otherwise they're false. Now consider these equations. Consider x is equal to 2, and let's go ahead and now square both sides of this equation to get x squared is equal to 4. And let's do the same thing. Well, the only number that makes this true would be the number 2. Let's put it in braces here. But for the second equation, there are actually two numbers that make this true. There's 2, but there's also negative 2. So we see right away that these two equations are not equivalent. Why? Well, because the first equation is true only when x is 2. The second equation is true when x is both 2 and negative 2. Okay, so what's the point? The point is that when you take an equation and you square both sides, you may end up getting numbers that make this equation true but don't make the original equation true. Okay, you may end up getting an equation that's not equivalent to the first. And that's going to be important when we solve radical equations. Let's go ahead and do that now and see how this issue plays into how this issue is important to consider. Okay, let's go ahead and solve. The square root of 2x plus 11 plus 2 equals x. So the first thing you do, and this is always true when you solve an equation involving a radical, you always isolate the radical, and that means you get it by itself. So we're going to subtract 2 from both sides, and we get the square root of 2x plus 11 equals x minus 2. And now we're going to square both sides. And we're going to do that to get rid of this radical. So if you square the left, you also have to square the right. And what happens? Well, the square root of 2x plus 11, right? If you square that, you get 2x plus 11. And the right-hand side, when we square that, we get, well, it's going to be x squared minus 4x plus 4. And now what you have here is a quadratic equation, right? Because x is being squared. And the way we solve those is we get everything on one side. So why don't we subtract 2x and subtract 11 from both sides? So we're going to get 0 is equal to x squared minus 6x minus 7. And now we're going to factor this right-hand side. So 0 is x minus 7 times x plus 1. And that gives us values of x, right? X is equal to 7, and x is equal to negative 1. Okay, now here's the important point. Notice how I squared both sides of the equation. That means what I got right here when I squared both sides may not be equivalent to the original. Let's go ahead and write that down. That the first equation and what I got after squaring, they may not be equivalent. What does that mean? Well, that means that there may be numbers that satisfy this equation, right, but don't satisfy the original. Well, 7 and negative 1 both satisfy this equation, but I'm not sure if they satisfy the original. I have to check them both. So we have to check both of them. And this isn't because maybe we made an error. This is because whenever you square both sides, you may have solutions to the latter equation that are not solutions to the beginning equation. Okay, so we're going to take 7 and we're going to replace x, right? So we're going to take the square root of, well, it's going to be 2 times 7 plus 11 plus 2. Is that equal to 7? Right? That's what we're trying to check here, right? Is that equal to x, which is 7? Well, it's going to be the square root of, let's see, 2 times 7 is 14 plus 11 is 25. And the square root of 25 is 5 plus 2. And yeah, that's equal to 7. What that means is that 7 truly is a solution. But when you go to check x equal negative 1, so now let's check x equals negative 1, we get the square root of 2 times negative 1 plus 11 plus 2. Is that equal to negative 1? Well, that's the square root of, let's see, negative 2 plus 11 is 9, and 9 plus 2, right? Is that equal to negative 1? Of course not. Square root of 9 is 3, and 3 plus 2, which is 5, that is not equal to negative 1. So what happened was, negative 1 satisfied this equation, but it didn't satisfy the original, and so we don't want it, right? It's what's called an extraneous solution. So that's what an extraneous solution is. It's a solution that appears using a technique to solve equations involving radicals. It may satisfy this equation, but it may not satisfy the original. However, x equals 7, that does work, right? So we keep that one. So what happens is, just to recap what we just talked about, whenever you solve a radical equation, the first thing you do is you isolate the radical, and then you square both sides, but the act of squaring may have introduced extraneous solutions, and that's why you have to check the numbers that you end up with at the end of that process. Okay, let's try another one like that. Let's solve the cube root of x plus 7 is equal to 5. Okay, once again, the first thing you do is you isolate the radical. So we're going to subtract 7 from both sides. So we get the cube root of x is equal to, well, it's going to be negative 2. And now I'm not going to square both sides, right? I'm going to cube both sides because I'm trying to undo the cube root. So I'm going to cube both sides. And what do I get? Well, this is going to be x. That's the whole point of doing it, right? Cubing undoes the cube root. And on the right-hand side, I get negative 8. Now, if you go to check negative 8, let's go ahead and try that really quickly. The cube root of negative 8 is negative 2, and negative 2 plus 7 is 5. That is, I do this, right? The cube root of negative 8 plus 7, is that equal to 5? Well, the cube root of negative 8 is negative 2 plus 7. That indeed is equal to 5, so it worked. So negative 8 truly is a solution. Now, this example is important and different than the previous in the following way. Do you see how I cubed both sides? Whenever you cube both sides or raise both sides to the fifth power or the seventh power or any odd exponent, whenever you do that, you never check. You never have to check. Why? Because it turns out that these equations will always be equivalent. It's only when you square both sides or raise both sides to the fourth or the sixth or any even exponent, like I did in the previous example, it's only when you have an even exponent that you have to check, okay? Because you may not get equivalent equations. So whenever you solve radical equations, you're trying to get rid of the radical and you have to raise both sides to a power. If the power is even, you better check both, or you know, whatever you get to make sure they truly are solutions. But if it's an odd exponent, there's no reason to check. Okay, and that's how you solve radical equations.